In the last video, we had gone through this example where we had the C source code, which had basically, you know, three lines of work, which was the load, the add, and the store. This was converted into, you know, five assembly instructions. And with our naive schedule, this took about 10 cycles to finish. And we said that this is not very efficient. So let's see if the compiler could have done a better job reordering instructions to eliminate some of these stall cycles and perhaps improve performance. Okay, so the first thing we're going to try and do, well, let's first look at the constraints, right? So we said that a load feeding an add is going to introduce a one cycle gap. And an add feeding a store is going to lead to a two cycle gap. So there's really not much we can do to compress this load, add, and store sequence. What I can do is perhaps move the R1 decrement and the branch to try and fill up these slots that are earlier in my execution. Okay, so let's see if I can move the dadd further up. Is there any dependence between the dadd and, let's say, the store? Well, so there is a dependence, right? The store needs the value R1, and this instruction is decrementing R1 by 8. Is it possible for me to perhaps nullify this effect? Okay, so if I move this dadd, say, up over here, it means R1 has already been decremented by 8. If I want to refer to the same address, I need to add 8 back. Thankfully, there's an easy way to do that, because, you know, every store instruction has this integer offset. If I change this integer offset from 0 to 8, then I'll be just fine. Okay, so I can move the dadd earlier up. Since it's being decremented by a constant, I can add the constant right back into the offset. Okay, the next thing I can do is try to move the branch earlier. And if I plug it in over here, the store is essentially being placed in the branch delay slot, which is totally fine because the instruction after the branch will always be fetched and executed. So that's a great way to execute the store. So this is what my code would now look like, right? It starts out with this sequence, and I've changed it so that the load is done first. Then I do this R1 decrement. Then I do the add, right? I am introducing a one cycle gap between these two. Then, because I need to introduce a two cycle gap between the add and the store, there's nothing I can do about this stall. And the branch comes right before the store. Okay, so executing the three instructions worth of work is now taking me 6 cycles. Okay, and ideally, I would like to do 3 instructions worth of work in exactly 3 cycles. I should actually be doing, you know, 3 cycles per iteration. But it's taking me 6 cycles per iteration, and that's because, you know, I have these two extra overhead instructions. So there's loop overhead, which is, you know, not doing real work, it's just kind of doing bookkeeping so that I can advance from one loop iteration to the next. Okay, and so, you know, is there a way for me to perhaps eliminate these stall cycles and eliminate this loop overhead? Okay, and the classic way to do that is with a technique called loop unrolling. Okay, so to reduce the loop overhead, what I say is, you know, instead of just doing one xi plus s and then moving on to the next iteration, let me do xi plus s for 4 different array variables, and then I'll advance to the next loop iteration. Okay, so I'm going to do load, add, store corresponding to the increment of xi. Then I will do load, add, store again. This corresponds to xi minus 1. Right, so you'll see that instead of an offset of 0 to R1, I'm doing a minus 8 offset to R1. So I don't have to explicitly decrement R1, I just change the offset. The compiler does this while producing these instructions. Then I do, again, load, add, store corresponding to xi minus 2, and then corresponding to xi minus 3, right? And the offsets are now, you know, minus 24 and minus 16. All right, and then having done, you know, 4 iterations worth of work, I then decrement R1 by 32 to jump to the next large iteration, and then I branch back up here. Okay, so now for, you know, 12 instructions worth of real work, I'm doing only 2 instructions worth of loop overhead, and that's right here. And let's see if this eliminates my stall cycles as well. Okay, let's see how I'm going to schedule this. If I wrote the schedule like this, I would introduce a stall cycle here and I would introduce 2 stall cycles here. So this is not a good schedule. Instead, what I'll do is something like this. I'll move all the 4 loads up front. So I'll do all these 4 loads at the very start. And this can be done because these 4 loads don't have any dependencies. There's no dependence among the 4 loads. Okay. Then I do the next batch of 4 ads, and this is fine because between this load and its consuming ad, there needs to be a 1-cycle gap. In this case, there's a 3-cycle gap, so I've plenty of spare room as well. And then I do the 4 stores, and interspersed in between are the R1 decrement and the branch, so that the last store is in the branch delay slot. Okay, and I said that between this ad and this store, there needs to be a 2-cycle gap. In this case, there's a 3-cycle gap. Okay, so this is going to work just fine. And so what I've been able to do is I've eliminated all stalls, and I have only 2 instructions worth of loop overhead per iteration. So now I'm doing, you know, 4 iterations worth of work, and this is being completed in 14 cycles. So now I'm taking, you know, 3.5 cycles per iteration, which is getting me pretty close to my ideal of 3 cycles per iteration. If I'd unrolled by degree 8, I would get even closer to that ideal, right? It would be down to 3.25 cycles per iteration. Okay, so the more I unroll, the less I suffer because of these loop overhead instructions. Okay, so what are the problems being introduced by loop unrolling? One, of course, is that it increases my program size, right? Before, I had this this really short binary, and now that binary has grown to this 14 instruction sequence. And not just that, not only do I need to have instructions to represent this one large loop, I also need the original loop placed over here. And why do I need that? It's because if you assume that my loop runs from 1 to n, the value of n is usually not known at compile time, right? That's something that is determined at runtime. Okay, so if I want to unroll by k, where k equals 4, I don't know if n is perfectly divisible by 4. Okay, so I have to assume that my large loop iterations will run from 1 to floor of n by 4. And then there might be a few more iterations that have still not been executed. Those will have to be done at the very end. So I may have to loop again for my original small loop. It's my original small loop, and I have to iterate from n by 4 times 4, and I have to iterate for until n. So basically this amounts to n mod 4 iterations. Okay, so a little more math than you were expecting, but this is not a very complex concept. What it says is, if I have 1007 iterations and I unroll by k equals 4, then I have to have 251 large iterations, which will essentially handle from 1 to 1004, and then I have to do 3 more small iterations, and that takes care of all 1007. Okay, where 3 is n mod k. Okay, so what I'm getting to is the fact that with loop unrolling, you not only need the original loop, you also need a larger version of the loop. So that leads to an increase in program size. It also requires more registers, because if you look at this code over here, note that the loads were now being done to F0, F6, F10, and F14, right? F6, F10, F14 were registers that I was not using before, right? And similarly, there are more registers being used over here. So loop unrolling definitely puts much greater pressure on the register file. Okay, so those are the problems with loop unrolling. So next video, I will look at a superscalar pipeline, and then I'll also talk about a technique called software pipelining.